visual realities, and the emotions are overstressed. He does it, for instance, by making the proportions between hands and legs and the body deliberately wrong. So the hands are larger, the feet are larger, in order to express a feeling and an emotion.
Naked legs, naked bootless, naked legs, possibly naked underneath, who would know? But it's very powerful that the man is wearing what looks like a World War I greatcoat, and the woman is wearing what looks like the luxurious underwear of the decadent Vienna of the pre-World War I days. And so you've got this collision of the two cultures that Schiele found himself caught up in so powerfully, the luxuriance and decadence of the end of an empire.
As Schiele put the finishing touches to his painting, he arranged a final meeting with Varley. Schiele had had a brilliant idea. He would explain to Varley how their relationship could continue after his marriage to Edith Harms. According to Schiele's friend Arthur Roessler, Varley and Egon met for the last time in his regular haunt, the Café Eichberger, where he played billiards almost every evening. Schiele took an envelope out of his jacket pocket and handed it to her with the mumbled words, "It's all in here." What Varley read was curious in the extreme. She didn't know whether to laugh or cry. What she held in her hand was no farewell letter, but the strangest of documents in which Schiele solemnly promised to go with her on several weeks' holiday every year.
But Egon, how do you picture this? Do you think that Edith will ever allow this? Or that I would agree to it? You mean well, I'm sure. But I've given up on you once and for all. And that's how it's going to stay.
Then Varley left without tears or sentimentality, but also without any bitterness, just sad, resolved to go on learning life. Sheila's farewell to Varley seems somewhat cruel, and there is a cruel streak to what Schiele painted in his first version of this picture. In this intriguing photo, we see that Schiele initially painted the woman's buttocks as naked.
There is a photograph of an earlier stage of the painting in which the woman's buttocks are exposed through a kind of rectangular opening in the back of her dress. And this has always struck me as very odd, because the final version of the painting does make the woman seem actually quite chaste.
It makes you feel that she's humiliated in some way, that her flesh is poking through, that she's seen as a sexual object, but not an erotic one. It makes you feel far more protective of her as somebody who has been the victim, almost, of the man who is both clasping and pushing her away. I think it would be a more shocking picture if he'd left it in the original state.
I think the first version is absolutely Schiele's true and passionate version. And if I would, as a collector, would have the choices of the two, I would obviously choose the first one.
Schiele's friend, Arthur Roessler, claims that he warned the artist the bare bottom was too provocative. Whatever his motive, Schiele decided he would protect Varley's modesty. For this programme, the Belvedere carried out its first infrared and UV examination of the painting. The results demonstrate that Schiele lavished an awful lot of paint on covering up Varley's backside.
The infrared and the UV photographs that we did recently show us very clearly what we know, a little bit more than we know before. It's the first version with the bare bottom here, and the same in the UV with the light green parts used as a paint to destroy the bare bottom.
When Schiele finished Death and the Maiden, he had himself photographed posing next to his masterpiece. The window of his studio is visible at the back of the photo. Cannily, Sheila colluded with the photographer to create an image of the artist scrutinizing himself in the mirror. In this photo, Sheila looks like a sharp young man, and his painting looks like a 20th century masterpiece. But in fact, Sheila's painting was the latest in a long line of images linking sex and death. The theme of death and the maiden, coupling a beautiful girl with a skeletal figure, had been recurring in Northern European paintings for 500 years.
It goes back as far as the 16th century, South German, Hans Baldung Green. You see it over and over again. You see a skeleton embracing a nubile young woman. Gorgeous, tight skin, touching her often in a very suggestive way.
In the 19th century, the image inspired one of the greatest songs in the German language, Schubert's Death and the Maiden. Artists such as Edvard Munch made the theme more erotic, emphasizing the sexual dimension of death caressing a young girl.
What Sheila does with Death and the Maiden is, of course, transpose it into a context which, to me, is eerily contemporary. This wasteland that could almost be a battlefield from World War I, couldn't it? It could be Verdun or the Somme or anywhere. But he's given us, in that extraordinary painting, this image of this collision between the allegorical theme that goes back for five centuries nearly, together with a very contemporary feel about the terrible anguished pain of modern man in World War I.
Sheila had succeeded in reinventing the idea of allegory in a contemporary style. He even surpassed the attempts at allegory painted by his master, Klimt.
Klimt tried to reinvent allegory, and indeed some of his subjects deal with death and women. Always a kind of joke death, it seems to me, lurking in the background. Now Sheila tries to, as it were, reinvent allegory again, and he tries to do it by basing his allegorical subjects and the figures on himself, together with a woman that he'd been living with for so long, Vali Neuziel, and whom he was about to dump. Death and the Maiden, indeed.
The painting looks back to old ideas of allegory in art. It also captures the new psychological ideas that were being pioneered in Vienna by Dr. Sigmund Freud.
It might also be a symbol of a very deep depression, because he had to leave Vali and he must have felt very badly. And so perhaps this, in a Freudian way, is his self-analysis.
Having completed Death and the Maiden, Sheila was called up by the army. Soon he found himself employed as an official war artist, though he never saw action in battle. In Vienna, there was a sense of living on borrowed time. One Viennese writer described Vienna as a laboratory for testing the end of the world. Another called the city a joyful apocalypse.
Vienna really was at the end of the road in terms of its long history as an empire, wasn't it?
It was all going to collapse. It was all going to go down or up in smoke. And I think we do find that in Sheila. There's one outburst he made once. Alles ist lebend tot. Everything is living dead, he said. And that's what so much of his art is about as well.
But death in this picture can also be seen as the death of the old Sheila. After Sheila's marriage to Edith Harms, he developed a new style. In his portraits, he moved away from agonized figures in isolation.
Sheila's style does change. It loses its edge. It becomes less obsessive, less haunted, less neurotic, more, dare I say, conventional. He locates these figures very much in an environment, and for the first time when he's painting in oils, he is actually producing a quality of paint, a sensuous quality, which he's not been interested in before.
Varley walked out of Sheila's painting and out of his life. She was determined to begin again, and the war offered her that opportunity. She joined the army as a nurse, but tragically, her new life didn't last long. In 1917, in a field hospital in Croatia, she contracted scarlet fever. A few days later, she died. The artist and his wife were not spared either. As the pandemic of Spanish flu spread across Europe, both Sheila and his wife, Edith, contracted the illness. A pregnant Edith died on the 28th of October, 1918. 4 days later, Sheila followed her. His last words were about himself.
The war is over and I must go. My paintings should be seen in museums around the world.
This fragile-looking man, holding a painting of sunflowers by Sheila, is Franz Martin Haberditzel, director of the Österreichische Gallery in the Belvedere during Sheila's lifetime.
Haberditzel was a very important director of the Österreichische Galerie, of course. And he met Egon Schiele very early, and he was the very first and also the only director worldwide who bought Egon Schiele painting directly from the living artist.
In 1930, Haberditzel bought Death and the Maiden for the Belvedere. 90 years after Sheila's death, his paintings draw thousands of people to the gallery. This couple, still clinging to each other, seem to address our own anxieties.
The expression on the man's face very much shows a slight fear, I think, of should he be there? And yet he's enjoying being there, and he hopes nobody knows he is there.
I think it's an image of love, yes. Yes, absolutely. Because it's also to embrace someone who's sick or dying or whatever, you must love someone, I think. Yes, I think it's a picture of love, definitely, yes.
It doesn't just feel personal about Sheila and his model. It feels how we all feel, I think, about the desperate nature of human relationships. We want to cling to them, but ultimately, whether it be through death or whether it be through loss of love or someone being removed from us by a huge and ghastly event, it will end. And he conveys that so powerfully.
The final part of Professor Jim Al-Khalili's fascinating series on quantum physics is next tonight on BBC4, Atom.